get set up. We're gonna get going. I got a teaching dropped on my lap, and I want to go over some stuff. Okay, so let's pray and get into this. Father God, we come before you. We thank you. We praise your holy name. We bless you. I dedicate this to you. I pray you speak through me from the Spirit. Get me out of the way. Lighten people's loads. That's what he just said. I pray you would take these heavy burdens and lighten people's loads, God. We crucify the flesh. We walk in the Spirit. He's saying to me, needle nose pliers. So, and what this means, it's like something I know, but the prophetic word here is just start doing it, whatever it is. Okay. If there's something that you've kind of been putting off, I mean, maybe not today, today's a day of rest or whatever, but going forward, just start doing it. Just knock down some things on a list, write them down, some things that you know you can get done. And as you build that, it'll increase your attitude. It'll give you a trajectory of moving up, you're accomplishing goals, okay? And focus on that so that you can build upon those little successes, okay? And that's the word. It's just needle nose pliers. It's just doing the little things. Start knocking them out. Get them done, okay? And if you don't get something done, do it tomorrow. Put it at the top of your list tomorrow and then start over and keep doing that. Keep building, okay? And you get and commit your day to God, and what you get done, and what you don't, do it the next day, okay? And don't be too hard on yourself. Father, we praise you. We bless you. We dedicate this word to you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. All right. I was digging into Revelation. I got some cool stuff out of Revelation 19 and 20. I'm excited about it. I know, guys, pray for Rhema and Revelation for me. Because there's some cool stuff that I'm seeing in Scripture. That being said, my phone jumped over to 1 Corinthians 1. I'm reading Revelation, and all of a sudden it went bloop, and it went over 1 Corinthians 1. I'm like, what the heck? And then it said, and the Lord's like, I want you to read this. I said, okay. And I started reading it, and I knew exactly what it was. He even told me what it was. He told me why I'm reading this. There was a prayer requested from another saint. And I know why this was requested. I understand all of it. God gave me the download on all of it, right? So 1 Corinthians 1 goes through, and it's about unity in the brethren, okay? And if you go down, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, whom shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now this part, this is what was here. This is what I was brought here for. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind, in the same judgment. For it hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe. And then he goes on and he's like, you know, were you baptized in the name of Apollos or in Cephas or in Christ or what? You know, he's saying that. He's like, no, you were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. This was Paul beseeching people to be of one mind, okay? And this is a good thing. Unity in the brethren is a good thing. I don't speak out against unity in the brethren, okay? However, I do speak out against unity of the brethren when everybody is doing their best to make excuses and to lower the bar, okay? And I refuse to be of one mind with people that are like that. When it says, that we're supposed to be of one mind and everything else, if everybody is lowering the standard constantly, patting each other on the back for sin or for whatever, and then when somebody comes along like myself and tries to elevate the bar a little bit, and I'm operating miracle signs and wonders, you get jealous in your inward man, and you start trying to pick this apart. This is what the Lord said to me. He said that this person tried to do this because they're scared of what they've done. They know in their heart that they chose the easy way out, friendship with a community and stuff like that, that's not in alignment with God, over a relationship with God because it was easier. Guys, and if we look at this like over time, this is what the Lord said. He said, I don't put new wine in old wineskins. I'm doing a new thing, and I'm not in these churches anymore. That's what he said to me. Okay, these guys are holding on to unity of the brethren, and then using a verse like this out of context of the entire scripture, rather than taking it for what it's actually supposed to mean. At this time when Paul was there, there was Apollos, Cephas, and Paul. These guys were operating in massive miracle signs and wonders. They had power everywhere they went, and they heard from God. Okay? That's what these guys did every single day. Until you have a Paul, a Cephas, or an Apollos, there's not going to be unity of the brethren. Unity of the brethren doesn't bring the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit brings unity of the brethren. And the Holy Spirit also decides and chooses who the Pauls, who the Apollos, and who the Cephases are. And unless you get on that page, you're never going to see that. And you're going to make excuses by explaining away in Scripture to pat yourself on the back, because that's what you always do. This is why we have a community of people living in active sin and making excuses for it. A community of people who are friends with the world, but also try to mix light and dark. Okay, you can't have that. Okay, I was walking by two or three days ago. This book is really good if you've never seen it. It's this guy, I learned a ton from him. It's Henry Groover, mighty man of God. He operated miracle signs and wonders. This guy was on his own most of the time. That's what the type of ministry that the Lord gave him was. He was on his own 99% of the time. He would go in and he would give teachings or conferences and stuff like that. But this man's ministry was on his own. He even talks about it in his book about how every time he would try to do a ministry with anybody else, the Lord would pull these people out because it was better for him to be on his own, because he could get in and out of areas and do this and that, right? You this from Henry Groover's book right here, okay? But this is also about how we are to treat these brethren. Like, this is what we're supposed to do for a brother or sister in Christ. To make this teaching complete, I want to go to the subject of blood guiltness in greater depth. What exactly is blood guiltness, and what effect does it have on our land? What does it do to our neighborhoods, our communities, and our cities? Basically, the idea behind this is it's a principle. This is why Satanists and stuff commit desecrations. This is why they sacrifice and they do horrible things. I just watched a thing about a woman who came out of these things, who sacrificed her own kids through abortion to Satan, because she said that they knew at that time this was the biggest insult and slap in the face they could do to God. When these things happen, it can bring a desecration on the land, okay? And if we know how to pray against these things, they can't do this. Their power is dissolved, okay? And this is stuff that they don't want getting out. This is why America's so dark. This is why when Obama legalized gay marriage, a desecration came on the land. It was a big thumb in the nose at God, and now every other kid thinks they're transgender. Like, that was the turning point at that time, in case you don't know how the spiritual stuff works. But this is the truth, okay? So when these things happen, when there's a murder like Ichabod Park, remember how I said we went to that park and we prayed over it It was like a 20-something-year-old, 30-year-old cold case where a guy cut a girl's head off. And I got sent to this park to go pray over this park. A couple other people went with me a couple times, but I was there and I was interceding, and they caught the guy. The crazy thing is a guy that worked for me in Flagstaff, I had a dream about him being like this murderer and stuff like that. His name was the same, and the guy's name is Patrick Miller. The same name that this guy that I hired was the name of the murderer. And so I'm seeing the guy that I hired, but it wasn't him. It was this other guy. And that was the guy that did these Ichabod Park killings, right? But when that happened, when that lady was dismembered and that murder happened at that park, a desecration was committed. One of the worst areas in Phoenix now is like the Shaw Butte area. It's horrible down there. It's one of the worst ghettos. There's heroin addicts everywhere in that park. They get high all day long in the middle of the park. But that's why. It was because a desecration happened. And that was 30 years ago. And since then, the whole place has gone straight to hell. Okay? And this is why. It's blood guiltness. Okay? When this happens, he's going to explain what happened. Remember Cain and Abel. God the Father asked Cain, "Where is your brother?" And Cain replied, "I know not. Am I my brother's keeper?" If you see, and then this is him. "If you cease to believe that you are your brother's keeper, you will never enter into the truth of remitting sins. You will be content with the fact that murder was committed and try to explain it away even before God." We are our brother's keeper. Okay? So even though I bring these stuff to attention and I talk about it and everything else, I forgive, I bless, and I remit those sins and I give it to God. Because God knows how to deal with his children a whole lot better than I do, unless he tells me something specifically to pray. This is what I do, okay? There are times when he tells me something specifically to pray, but that's what we're called to do, guys. Especially when there's people who are more ignorant and they're not as advanced or anything like that in how stuff works. They don't have self-awareness, all this other stuff. You got to have grace with these people. Like, really, I mean, it's like dealing with somebody who has like a low functioning mental level. Okay. If they're doing stuff and they got they're like 6 or 7 years old mentally, but they look like they're 30, you don't hold them to the same accountability that you do somebody who knows better. They know better, right? Spiritually, this is the same thing. This is what we do. But there has to be a certain amount of accountability when people don't have an excuse. There's no excuse for somebody who's just lazy or an outright refusal to follow God. That's different than this, right? This is why when they're new to Christianity and stuff, we have grace with them. It's new wine. We need to bring those people in and love on them, pat them on the back. But these people who've been around for a long time, no, there's no excuse. And if you're not like mentally handicapped, there's no excuse. There's absolutely zero excuse for you, okay? Cain knew where his brother was. He had buried him. He had spilled his own brother's blood, and the father knew it. What did God say? "The voice of my brother's blood crieth out from the ground." When that happened, the blood from the ground cries out, okay? If you know there's a desecration in your area, your neighborhood, or something like that, you can remit it, guys. You just ask God to forgive it. Or remit it, okay? And then remove it. And then plead the blood of Jesus over it. That innocent blood, the voice of the brother's blood that cries out from the ground, it's like disturbing an Indian burial ground. You go in there, if you desecrate those bodies, the voice of those bodies cries out to the Most High. Just because they weren't Christian doesn't mean they still don't, like, there's people that follow the Holy Spirit and don't even know it. Okay, that haven't heard the gospel. I'm not talking about people who've heard the gospel, but this is the truth. I saw a thing in Cherokee legend. There was when the day Jesus Christ was crucified, all the way over in America, the holy men, they have it written in their passed down traditions, right? It wasn't oral tradition, it was actually written down. It was the exact same time that Jesus would have been crucified. It was like 2,000 years ago. Their holy men said they saw the angels flying in the heavens, crying out and weeping that day. And all their elders, the holy men, said that a great, mighty man of God had been slain that day. They knew about it in the New World, and these were Cherokees, and this is actually written down, okay? There's men that followed the Holy Spirit. This is probably the same people that Jesus went and witnessed to in Peter when he went down to hell, but I'm not going to go into that right now. Let's get back on track. I have heard innocent blood crying from the ground on several continents, right? So this is Henry Gruber. He's gone all over the place. If you haven't seen his stuff, go look, guys. This is the ministry that the Lord gave me was like straight up out of Henry Gruber. This is the exact same thing that I do that we get sent all over to do. Go watch his stuff. It's really good. He went to our old church as like a guest speaker and stuff like that. In fact, he brought revival to our old church like a long time ago. They were a Baptist church and Henry Gruber came in. And the Holy Spirit caught fire and dropped, and they turned into like a Pentecostal, okay? So this is really cool. But listen, as I have already written, it stopped me dead in my tracks when I first heard it. I have heard so loud at times that it was almost deafening. In the area of Siberia, where many saints had been martyred, the Lord sent him to Siberia. How cool is that? This was probably from Stalin locking people up in the gulags that were Christians when the Christian persecution came because of the communists. I could hardly sleep for 9 days and nights. He couldn't sleep when he was there from the innocent blood that was crying out from the land until I find myself at a point of exhaustion. So that friend of mine said, oh, well, Henry Gruber never lost sleep. It's right here. If you go to the book of Psalms, look at how many times David lost sleep when there was stuff going on, when there's spiritual warring going on, right? It was a way to ridicule me and make me look bad, straight up. I bless him. I forgive him. I remit his sins, right? But this is the truth, man. Like, if people don't want to hear what they have, what you have to say, they'll do whatever it takes to sit there and cut you up. Here's the other thing, and I'm going to be serious for a minute. Fire! Right now, the enemy's attempt, I got this yesterday, okay? The enemy's attempt, they're trying to destroy the move of God within the body of Christ through these type of attacks, through people within the body of Christ who are straight up being manipulated and sent by the devil. They're torpedoes. I got a text message last night that was bad, okay? I got, like, this is how it works. And what it is it's there's people who they don't feel validated or they are miserable. There's all kinds of things that are going on in their life that's not right. And look, I feel really bad for them. But I also feel like there's got to be a certain amount of accountability in each person so that we rise above this stuff and that we don't continue to just inflict abuse and pain and hurts on each other, right? But this is the attack of Satan, is sent from within the body of Christ to destroy each other. It's like a kingdom divided cannot stand, and this is why. But there cannot be unity in the brethren until everybody's seeking the treasure in their heart, and that treasure has to be Jesus Christ and not the brethren. Okay. That's what he just said. The treasure in your heart. He was in Siberia. He could hardly sleep for 9 days, found himself in exhaustion. He would fall asleep for about an hour and a half, then stir out of that sleep, hearing those cries. He would get up and walk the floor, reading Isaiah 53, clinging to it and embracing it. I would cry out to the Lord, you haven't given me any understanding of what I'm experiencing. I know this. I know exactly what he's talking about here. I've gone through times where I've had this exact same thing and I'm crying out to the Lord, please give me understanding. Please let me know what it is that I'm experiencing. Where is this coming from? And then like I start getting angry with the Lord because I'm going through this suffering or things like that. And he brings me back. One time I found out I was standing in the gap and there was a sex trafficking ring. They were bringing people in from South America and trading these kids in a sex trafficking ring. And I was standing in the gap the entire time and I didn't even know it. Oh man. At the end of whatever the thing was that I went through, I got approached in the spirit by these families, and I saw them, and they were thanking me, and they were Christians. They were brothers and sisters in Christ, you know, from like Central and South America, like probably, you know, Guatemala or something like that. I have no idea. And they had been trafficked, and they were using these people as modern day slavery for horrible things. And like, I was hurting so bad. I was upset with the Lord. But then when it broke and we got through the other side and I saw what the battle was that I was fighting, man, I was filled with the goodness of God, because I knew it was for something, man. So I'll go through that if I have to. You know what I mean? But straight up, man, that's like, I get it. I get what Henry Gruber was going through here. He said, I had no idea what it was all about until the end of the ninth day. And that's what happened with me. As I was walking that city, my bronchial tubes froze. It was April. The sun was shining and didn't cover my face. What I didn't realize was that it was just 20 degrees below zero. I didn't know what had happened to me. I just knew that the fever and the pain of every breath I took, combined with the inability to sleep more than an hour or so, was like torture. I kept walking because I kept hearing the cries of the innocent blood, particularly on one hill above the city. I kept remitting the sins of the innocent blood, but the Lord wouldn't tell me what had happened on that hill. I just got that. I was like thinking to myself, why did he have to speak out like the sin, like that specific sin? Like, why wasn't it enough? He wanted a witness. He wanted somebody to testify to what our brothers and sisters had gone through there. And that's why it took him 9 days to go through that. That's why it wasn't just enough just to remit the sin. He wanted a witness. He wanted somebody to speak what happened and to declare it and to bring it in a book and then have some guy know on the internet talking about it. That's why. Okay. I'm going to end that here, guys. We are a brother's keeper. And we have to act like it. Forgive your brothers and sisters. Stop being idiots. Make good choices. And stop seeking fellowship and unity of the brethren more than you're seeking Lord and staying plugged in with the Lord. Because then unity of the brethren will come. That will bring unity of the brethren. Unity of the brethren will not bring him. It's the other way around. God bless you guys. Have a good day.